Thanks everybody for coming out. I think it's going to be a treat tonight, to say the least. The Insights Design Lecture Series has been in existence for over 35 years now and is a collaboration between the Walker Art Center and the AIGA Minnesota. So I want to thank all of my colleagues at AIGA Minnesota, especially Brent Sickles, for what is an enduring and sort of amazing partnership, and allows us to bring really great designers, usually to the Twin Cities, most recently virtually to the Twin Cities. And with Eric and Aaron, they're already from the Twin Cities, so it all works out. AIGA puts on some amazing design events. So if you get a chance, go to AIGAMinnesota.org and you can see what events that they've got coming up. So tonight's guests, Eric and Aaron, both of whom came up in the Minneapolis creative scene, have worked with probably a lot of you. I'm guessing there's a lot of friends in the audience tonight, but in Minnesota, they've also worked with plenty of arts organizations, including the Walker, in one capacity or another. So I think, again, it's going to be a really special night. We're going to be talking about a lot of things, including people. You know, we're going to talk about a lot of work and how they make their work in the process, but the way they talk about their work is often through talking about people. The unofficial title, or the working title for tonight's talk that they've given me, is How to Be a Human. So this idea of how people work together, survive a pandemic together, and ultimately create beauty together will be woven through the conversation. And this is what I think most attracts me to their work. There's an integrity to their ongoing creative compulsions, and there's an integrity in the fact that they do it with the people that they want to work with, and they build their creative community one project at a time, which could sound simple enough. But another thing we're going to talk about tonight is also the ways in which certain creative industries or practices can also make it harder to be a human. Really quick, I'll give you some bio information. First up, Eric Timothy Carlson. Eric maintains an independent art and design studio, creating work with clients, making music, putting on exhibitions of his work, and collaborating with a wide range of people, such as artists Peter Burr and Annie Larson. He has exhibited with institutions such as Printed Matter and Fisher Parrish Gallery, and he is the creative director for music collective Bon Iver. He and Aaron Anderson have worked together in various capacities for 15 years now. Aaron is a filmmaker, artist, and musician, and a member of the band Beat Detectives. He has presented at a variety of institutions, including MoMA PS1, Mass MoCA, the Van Abbey Museum, and has worked in various AV-related roles at the Guggenheim, the Metropolitan Museum of Art, the Museum of Arts and Design, the New Museum, and the Walker, where he was the projectionist and film technician from 2005 to 2010. So that was a long time ago. Both Eric and Aaron graduated from the Minneapolis College of Art and Design. Their work with Bon Iver was nominated for both a 2020 Beazley Design of the Year Award, as well as a Grammy. I think maybe two Grammys, maybe one Grammy. So they are officially Grammy nominated artists, which is how I refer to them when I introduce them to people. But before the conversation starts, and we'll tell you a little bit about how the conversation is going to be set up. Eric and Aaron wanted to show I wanted to show one slide real quick. This is, I believe these are diagrams of tonight's talk in a certain way. Aaron, you drew these, right?
Yeah.
So these were kind of a way of capturing everything that we're going to be talking about tonight. So literally, if you guys can take a screen grab and then make sure we hit every single one of these points, I think that's the way to do it. All right, so we Eric and Aaron wanted to start with a video clip. It's one of the newest projects they've made. I think they just finished it, and it's an excerpt of a piece called Catalog of Unabashed Gratitude by poet Ross Gay, with music by Bon Iver.
Friends, will you bear with me today? For I have awakened from a dream in which a robin made with its shabby wings a kind of veil, behind which it shimmied and stomped something from the south of Spain, its breast aflare, looking me dead in the eye from the branch that grew into my window. And thank you, friends, thank you who did not bulldoze the ancient grove of dates and olives, who sailed his keys into the ocean and walked softly home, who did not fire, who did not plunge the head into the toilet, who said, stop, don't do that, who lifted some broken someone up, who volunteered the way a plant birthed of the reseeding plant is called a volunteer, like the plum tree that marched beside the raised bed in my garden, like the arugula that marched itself between the blueberries. Nary a bayonet, nary an army, nary a nation, which usage of the word volunteer, familiar to gardeners the wide world, made my pal shout, oh, thank you. Thank you, stumbling into the garden where the Juneberry's flowers had burst open like the bells of French horns. The lily my mother and I planted oozed into the air. The bazillion ants labored in their earthen workshops below. The collard greens waved in the wind like the sails of ships, and the wasps swam in the mint bloom's viscous swill. And you, soon it will be over. Which is precisely what the child in my dream said, holding my hand, pointing at the roiling sea and the sky, hurtling our way like so many buffalo, who said, it's much worse than we think, and sooner. To whom I said, no duh, child in my dreams. What do you think this singing and shuddering is? What this screaming and reaching and dancing and crying is, other than loving what every second goes away. Goodbye, I mean to say. And thank you, every day.
That it still gives me chills.
This is going to be hard. I think we're supposed to like launch into like talking about some stuff according to
yeah.
Like, how do we watch something like that without unpacking it just a little bit?
Yeah, I mean, I gotta say that. I mean, so that was one of the most recent projects that we have accomplished in the last year, and came out a month or so ago. And it was such a honor to be able to work with Ross's poetry on that. It's so powerful, and I have, you know, watched that video however many times at this point, but it still like gives me chills just because he's so incredible. But so we started with the end, and so we can go into the beginning now, I suppose. How do we start?
What are we looking at?
All right. So Aaron and I both graduated MCAD, and it was like while I was finishing school, the two of us started working together. We started working on drawings together, and
we were making stuff for a lot of people. We were working with a lot of bands, and like Minneapolis is kind of a music centric town in a way. Like that was kind of like a easy way to communicate with a lot of different people from a lot of different places, sort of in a weird way, like bands and that kind of like playing shows in different parts of town with different bands who are from St. Paul or, you know, the opposite side of Minneapolis or whatever.
So working with music, doing like album art, posters, so on and so forth, was one thing, but I think we were also putting together our own exhibitions and DIY spaces and galleries and institutions shortly thereafter. But a lot of it continued to employ like bringing the musicians we were working with into some of those exhibitions and into the artwork and playing our own music and doing artwork for our own music, and making videos with, you know, in every aspect of making.
And a lot of it too was sort of like working with kind of like creating a like a system or something for the people we were working when we worked with them, they had to participate. So it was like they had to come up with an alter ego or like a some sort of alias that was outside of what they were sort of pre-existing as, and they had to like work with the system that we were kind of trying to set up around it to like create a separate narrative, but like show that everything was connected, I guess. If that, maybe that's a little too abstract for right now, but
we started a kind of collective, started calling this collective work we were doing Hardland Heartland, and it was us and it was so many other people laced through the Minneapolis community, and Crystal Quinn, who is somewhere in this mix and we could bring her in the fold perhaps, was, hey Crystal, your audio's off. There you are.
Got it.
You look cool.
Early on in doing these kind of collaborative processes, we started working with Crystal, and we were doing an installation at the Soap Factory, and she was making these costumes, and there was musical performances happening, and after that project, we kind of just never stopped working together, and so much of it was spending time at her house and drawing multiple days a week and forever will have influenced everything that I've done after that. I like learned so much from working with Crystal, and she's here because of how important she was to just kind of like establishing what the practice is now. Hi, Crystal.
Hey, they're crying.
Hi.
Yeah.
So Aaron and Eric, you brought Crystal on to basically try to make her cry.
Yeah, work.
Good. Definitely.
Doesn't take much, but.
I mean, I know what you guys, we talked about this previously, that you saw a lot of potential. Something clicked when you started working with DIY spaces and you started working with bands, and then you realized that what you were doing with your drawing could be expanded into these larger moments that bring a lot of people into it. You also talked about this idea of tuning a space, which was that relevant in this moment in time?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it was sort of just like being able to walk into a space and be able to like change it or transform it into something that was ours for a brief period of time, I guess, is sort of like the idea. I mean, it's kind of like you walk in and like zero it out some way, like sweep it up and clean it up and then, you know, start arranging within that.
I mean,
space sort of, or like spirit carpentry was like another term we would use, which is just kind of like bad installation techniques ultimately, but it like allowed for like kind of like a free way of working and not necessarily like being totally familiar with the rules, but like knowing that they exist and wanting to mess with that a little bit, I guess.
Well, I think of Crystal with this too, where, I mean, the kind of like effortless mark making, I think of you in like having, I don't know, approaching like drawing and image making and art making with like kind of a joy, or like wanting things needing to be fun while we were doing it. And if it's not fun, if you're not interested, like you need to be doing something else.
I was gonna say that's totally right on, and I think what you're talking about, space and walking to space and just sort of like making things, it's sort of like what we've like always sort of said, which is like everything is a painting, which is like a space is a painting. Everything that you're putting together on a computer, on paper, whatever, it's like all the experience, which is a painting in a sense.
Yeah, or just important, or like
important as a painting is important, for sure. Exactly.
Like,
I got one thing that I want to address in this first section. We've already kind of like gone over the time limit before the next video. But one of the ways that we kind of established that we would work with the multitude of people and a way to make that function is we address it as piles a lot of times in our document here. But it's like piles, and it's like how you can get together with a handful of friends and kind of just like sit down and make a space to be generating. And we would, you know, we made hundreds and hundreds of drawings together, and then an exhibition would be sometimes all of them. But you know, how much you kind of you make a space to be creative and to be productive, and then you can kind of like work through these piles and kind of like create the presentable documents. And I think a lot of these images kind of serve to demonstrate that. But that process of just kind of like profuse generation is something that we've continued to use for the 15 years since we started doing this. Should cue the next video if you want to stare anywhere on this track. But thank you for joining us, Crystal.
Yeah.
Thanks, Crystal.
Thanks for having me.
All right, next vid coming up. This is a Beat Detectives video. We'll just jump right in.
Yeah, just let it roll.
Let it rip.
Yeah. The name of the movie.
This album is called Nefertiti Abstract Movie.
What's so wonderful is that anybody can do anything. Time can roll back.
That was a great sizzle reel.
Did it?
Did it pain you, Aaron, to make that? I know
it did actually.
Those transitions.
It already bothers me. So I guess I can talk about this. This is sort of the next stage of Eric and I working together, and like the images in the slideshow will sort of be stuff that we were kind of making after we both moved to New York. Eric moved here in 2011. I moved here in 2012. And for me, like Beat Detectives is something that I started with Chris Hontos and our friend Oakley and Oakley Topola and our friend Derek, actually, when we first started. But kind of was a recording project that was all of us in Minneapolis, and we were kind of playing party music and basements. And then when I moved here, we kept working together wireless, like through email, but I was also like focusing, I was just like making a lot of videos to go with it. And then kind of just started to really like, that was kind of the only thing that I started working on, was like video and music once I moved out here, just because spatially it was the only thing that was affordable to me to take up that much space in a lot of ways. And then it just kind of became like a full-time side project. And Chris moved out here probably like 3 years after I moved out here. And him and Eric and I were sharing a studio for probably about 5 years. And then a year ago, we moved in, Eric moved into the studio we're in now, and we're in a different studio, but it's ongoing, and sound is just as much a part of our life as music is, I guess, or video is at this point in time, and images and everything. But that's the quick pitch, I guess, on that.
The Beat Detective's pitch. So like, yeah, the video work that happened inside of, you know, alongside the Beat Detective's kind of like push into the New York residency, alongside kind of like reestablishing personal practices, moving to New York with band's video work, but also kind of like figuring out what an individual studio practice is, what the drawings are, what sustaining life on freelance work, and like the couple year learning curve as far as like making that function was important, an important component of it. But then like with the video work happening, with the Beat Detective stuff, that became more and more laced into, I guess, what we were able to do as a design studio. It's not really what we consider it, but I guess being able to offer like the video work and the graphic work together became a powerful component of like living off of this part of our creative output.
Eric, I'm curious, you mentioned that you're a studio, but then you also don't call yourselves a studio. You've referred to that before as like an anti-studio. I'm really curious, like, you guys, you know, traverse a lot of different kind of creative worlds. Like, you'll have personal practices, you'll do client-based work. You work together so often that you might as well be a studio. I don't know what that means. Or you'll work with a collective. I mean, what does it mean to you to like, why are you not a studio, I guess?
I mean, yeah, I think functionally, yes. And it's been one of those conversations that has existed for a decade, where it's like the studio, and the studio is the physical space that we find ourselves in to like, you know, hang and work and have the people over and be productive, and whatever, Crystal's living room and stuff like that is very much that. But then there's, of course, this kind of like functional, professional studio approach. And, you know, so much of that is just like having a name and a website and an LLC. And it's really all you need to say that you're like a professional design studio in so many ways. And I don't know, there's a push towards that kind of professionalization. And like, I feel that in my gut, like that push, the pull, in the same way that you're like, feel pulled to be like, I need to go to an MFA program or something like that. And then there's that also, you know, the angel on your shoulder or the devil on your shoulder is just like, no, you don't. Like, do your thing, just keep going. You got to listen to that too. Part of the approach that I feel we've inherently undertaken is to like continue to be, humans, true to ourselves, like to our artistic creative practices, and like not, I don't know, it's just like, sometimes it's such a bummer to feel like you're messing up by not like branding yourself. But I like that, you know, Aaron is Aaron Anderson. I like being Eric Carlson. And I like that we get to work together and we get to be connected and like, you know, thought of together, but also regarded as real human beings making these decisions and moving forward. And I think that, I like how real that is.
I mean, it's also one of those things too, where as far as having to be in intimate people, intimate situations with people who are being creative. If you're not a, if you're just like people, it's easier to interface with that, I think. You know, it's not like a, there is no brand strategy to like getting to the place on time. It's just like, I have to pick up Eric on the way, sort of, you know, and there's like no craft services or like certain things that are kind of part of like a larger studio system or like the idea of like what a good studio is providing for somebody or something like that, you know.
Did you guys ever consider working for studios when you were in New York?
Not. I worked at museums for the most part, did freelance both. That was sort of my ability to not have to interface with studios. We probably like didn't learn a lot of those ways of interfacing though.
I did a funny crash course, like entering into New York, kind of trying anything, and because I needed something. You know, I was entirely living off of pretty much album art designs for Minneapolis artists while I was already, you know, had moved to New York, but like I didn't have a footprint here really. So like I interviewed for a thing, and pretty much any interview I ever had, like at some sort of design studio, was like I don't know if you would be happy here. I'm like, of course I wouldn't, but like I need a job, you know. But you know, or like I was doing an internship at a gallery once. I quit trying to parallel park a car, and and I just kept on having like the feeling where I was just like, I would, all of my time trying to get a job would be much more well spent trying to get any single freelance gig just in my own studio. Mm-hmm. And you know, we actually struck up, there was a relationship we had with a small studio, this guy, Ben Pagel. And there was an interesting kind of group of projects we did with him. Astral Studio was their thing, but we kind of like gave them our portfolio and had them kind of like look for something that would work with what we were capable of doing. We ended up working with Performance Space 122 for a number of years, doing posters and animation stuff with them as they were kind of between physical spaces. And so like our kind of ongoing campaign of illustration and animations was the institution in transit. So but that's kind of like the closest thing ultimately.
Everybody in the chat is saying the word gangs.
Yep. Mm.
Just they won't stop. So what's up? Do you have a response for them?
Well, so that maybe helps transition into that. Ryan Olson was a Minneapolis musician, producer, collaborator, and have had a long relationship working with him, spawning out of a relationship working with like Building Better Bombs, and ended up doing this Symbol for the Gangs album. And doing that, and I'm not entirely sure, but doing that is probably one of the things that like kind of put our work in sight of the Bon Iver stuff with Justin Vernon. And it was, I think it was even before I had moved to New York, like I got a DM from Justin being like, oh, we should work on something sometime. And it was 3 years later that it was like, all right, we're working on something. You should come over. And that, you know, so that whole relationship grew into ultimately doing the artwork for 22 a Million, the Bon Iver 22 a Million. And after doing that,
roll it,
became their art director. We're gonna watch a little video from 22 a Million.
Down along the creek, I remember something. Heard the heron hurried away. First I breached that last Sunday. Low moon down the yellow road, I remember.
was something. Then leaving wasn't easy, and all that heaving in my rhymes. And I'm certain that it's evening, and it's now or it's not the time. Ooh. Toiling with your blood, I remember something. Beyond rushing, kissing on a night, second to last. Finding both your hands if second sun came past the glass. And oh, I know it felt right, I had you in my grasp. Oh, then how are we gonna cry? Cause it once might not mean something. Love a second glance, it is not something that we need. Honey, understand that I have been left here in the reeds. But all I'm trying to do is get my feet up from the creeks. And I'll see you turn around, you may. Turn around now, you're my 18. Goddamn, turn around now, you're my 18.
All right, yeah, that was me text editing.
Let's just watch that again. I mean, I've got a ton of questions about this, but I don't know if you guys want to
let them rip.
Okay, so the previous section, you had really been diving deep into like video editing, which was kind of an extension, like a motion-based extension of your drawing and your collage work. So there's kind of an evolution here. At some point, you know, Justin sees it and then I contacts you, Eric,
yeah,
to then start working on like packaging specifically, or was it always lyric videos from the beginning?
It was like the album art, and it was a cool start. It was like the best start, where it was kind of like, we want to work on something. We're not defining what it is we're working on. You know, the first year was really just kind of like, you know, getting to know each other and like hanging out and listening to music and talking about art and talking about, you know, what's good, and just feeling it out. And so like spending time at April Base, kind of just like, kind of taking it like a residency approach from the start there. And you know, many conversations just about like, let's not define what we're working on before we've worked for a while and figure out what feels right. Granted, plenty of great direction from the beginning on this project as well, but we had really kind of made it through to the point where we, years of process, getting to the point of like having direction for the album artwork before we were kind of able to come through with support for like the full album video approach. And that was kind of like, it was like, they know that we have this video stuff going. And when they finally came back with kind of like, let's do lyric videos for all of the videos. And it's like, lyric videos, funny, okay. And but it was a perfect opportunity to kind of like include all of this kind of digital process and collage that kind of coexisted alongside the drawings that was largely the 22 work. And it was perfect because it just like expanded the vocabulary of that project like immensely, and it ultimately opened roads for kind of years to come as well. So what's playing then on the screen right now is what, you know, years after 22 came out, but kind of directly led into this, was the Bon Iver collaboration with Two Dance, which we ultimately worked on for also like 2 years plus touring this. Aaron and I made this like a live, like analog playback video program, to play with the limited live Bon Iver set with 10 dancers, played Hollywood Bowl, played King's Theater, played around the States. But it, like the prompt in us
playing the part in this that we did was kind of a direct response to the lyric videos. I'm just gonna skip back a little bit and we can keep on for a second. We have the next video is an II video, which that whole album was approached kind of with the video much more on the forefront of intention, but also coming after Come Through. So the dance was a very significant part of the process and that we were approaching it with as well. So should I just jump into the video or?
Yeah, go for it.
Great.
I have a question.
Ask it.
Can you just tell us about that day? You know, like the dancing in the desert, like how did that come? I mean, you've spoken about the residency, but how does that work? Like, how did you work with the dancers?
We shot in El Paso, or like on this ranch kind of outside of El Paso. And we would kind of get up at 10 every morning, maybe. And
eat breakfast
as a group and then about 11 o'clock, we would run through what we were going to shoot. And the way that was sort of, it was like the choreography was sort of thought of as, it was discussed as being like source material from the start. So it wasn't necessarily like choreographed to the song from beginning to end. Mm-hmm. So we would go out knowing kind of what footage we were shooting for, or the song. And then we would go out and shoot for maybe like 2 hours. Like that was in a quarry kind of across the street from the studio that we were working at.
But it was a, multiple week kind of like, Where for the band, they were, it was ultimately a month or nearly two, but they were finishing recording the album in the recording studios. And there was, a flux of anywhere from, 10, 15 people at the ranch in a given day. But musicians and Graham Tolbert shooting the photography and the dancers.
Andra.
As you mentioned, we've talked about it as this kind of like residency experience. And one of the approaches to II, so like bringing back in like the idea of like the piles that were addressed with Crystal, was this approach of like shooting a lot of photography. There was a prompt to approach this album with collage, kind of heavy on the mind, but shooting a lot of photography over the course of a year, working on drawings that associated themselves with the album in whole and the songs individually, making the prints, making the cuts, making collages, working with portraits from everybody involved, working with the dance, working with the video, all of these kind of like categories on the front end were kind of like set up as containers for us. So again, not deciding like what the album art would be or like what the videos were going to be necessarily, as much as setting forth the containers, organizing the containers and then filling them, and then like spending that 6 months after 2 years of generating to kind of like reeling it all in and making the artwork and the videos and everything kind of like out of that accumulated material.
You had mentioned collaborating with everyone in the Bon Iver collective. It's partially like they're inviting you in to both work together, to have, like work relationships with each other, and then ultimately to be like friends and to be like people with each other.
Yeah.
As opposed to maybe other, client-based relationships, which can also be quite meaningful, but are also sort of have like a sort of fiscal relationship underneath them. I guess my question is, you've also sort of mentioned there's potentially a flip side to that equation, to the depth of the collaboration. Is there something about the responsibility that you feel towards each other to like help each other make as good a piece or as great work as possible that can be overwhelming sometimes?
I don't know if it's overwhelming, but I mean, I guess it's just like, nice to have someone that is going to check that or like be paying attention to that stuff. And like what working with Crystal and Eric, it was like the just taking it really seriously. And like, if this is just going to be on a screen, it doesn't mean that it can't look really good or like be important in that aspect. And I think that is like, that's ongoing, like, just making sure it's not getting lazy or,
I think that it's such a good relationship for, as far as like, art directing a project, making work for a band with a band, where we've been given a lot of trust to kind of follow through with how we approach things and what we're interested in
in creating. And, you know, a lot of what we make, we're not being asked to do this in a lot of ways. Like we wouldn't, and it wouldn't be recommended that we approach certain things in the way that we do by a lot of other people. But that's kind of like what can be good about it, where it's like anyone in the audience perhaps could like imagine what Bon Iver is supposed to look like. And I don't care like about that so readily, or, you know, care a lot about that, but like, I think you know what I'm saying. But I feel like we've been given a lot of trust and a lot of respect in making our contribution to the project. And a lot of it is kind of like, you know, we have music shared and we have conversations, you know, with the band. And for the most part, anytime we come back, like if we're excited in what we are pursuing, the response is typically like ready to pick up what we put down, like with the work. What we're looking at here is kind of introduction into, I guess, this kind of like post-COVID working stuff. So we'll jump into the two Bon Iver season 5 videos. We have a little mashup of the two, Ate Up All Their Cake and Please Don't Live in Fear. So maybe if we can get Randall queued up in the video on the side,
oh, yes. We'll have him. What's up, Randall?
I'm hanging. Yeah.
How's it going? That guy.
Hey, homies.
How's it going, Randall?
This is so much fun.
I love it.
So good to see you here.
No, thanks for having me. It's an honor.
Thank you.
So yeah, we shot the video with Randall, was it end of April? And it was kind of, COVID was coming on strong, and it was kind of like the anxiety about that whole thing everywhere, and certainly in New York, but everywhere obviously was like this kind of such a heavy thing and so many more questions than we, you know, did, whatever. And, you know, Aaron and I had spent a little time in the studio together, but for the most part, we were all pretty truly locked down, and the PDLIF video, the animated one, was like definitely animated on the floor of my apartment. But so getting out with you for Ate Up All Their Cake was really one of the first times in that space that we stepped out into the world. And we met up with Randall in Midtown, and then another session up in Mount Washington.
Mount Vernon.
I'm sorry, yes.
Close.
Not LA. And it was really important for me, for us, I know it. And would just love to hear.
Yeah, what do you remember?
What do you remember, Randall?
No, it's so crazy because, like you said, that was the first time that either of us had like been around other people besides like other artists, not creating something to be done indoor, at least. So it was super thick. I had like just relocated back to New York as well. So I'm like trying to get reacclimated to home in the middle of a pandemic, in the thick of it. And also all this like social unrest, a lot of stuff that just happened with a lot of protests that just happened over in Minneapolis. So I had to cross over into New York because of the George Floyd murder. Mm-hmm. So it was just like a super heavy time, but also the most like perfect time to just like be a person on top of being an artist.
Yeah, it felt so normal.
Our moment with you felt normal, as you put it. It was beautiful. It was really beautiful just to go and do that and to work with you. It was stabilizing in so many ways.
Yeah, a grounding point for sure, for me at least. Yeah.
We're working on a new project. We're not going to get into it, but continuing to work with Randall and our friend Christian. And I'm so excited to continue making stuff with you.
Ditto. 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 So much love. Yeah, it's a good time to have an exchange with these gentlemen.
All right. Well, I'm so happy you could make it in on this. Yeah. So I guess this section in a lot of ways was kind of set aside to open up the space towards like working in
COVID.
In COVID.
Or in a quarantine. In quarantine. In isolation.
You had sort of said in a previous conversation that your practice was almost suited to this moment. Like you were.
I don't know if it was suited, but I did make a deliberate attempt a couple of years ago to just walk to work. And like, you know, live within a pretty small like area, locale, and keep it local, I guess, to a certain degree.
Definitely part of it. I mean, and I think of it, you know, saying that early on in jest, I feel like it comes out of like those phone conversations where it's like you touch base with somebody in week six and you're like, oh man, so good to hear your voice. How's it going? Yeah, no, everything sucks, of course. But then you're like, for the most part, you know, we go to our studios every day. like in so many ways, like so many artists kind of like have that practice already where there can be an inherent isolation to having certain kinds of artistic practices. And this work takes time, you know, so much of all of this stuff that we're looking at, like, some of these videos are hundreds of hours, or like the scope of some of these projects takes years. And so it's,
I guess for me, it was just like an easy way to like not freak out too, was just to like keep the hands busy and the mind busy, you know?
Definitely.
Like as opposed to just sitting in my room and having anxiety attacks or something.
I mean, and the other component of it is that I've thought about it in the context of like working, contract, freelance, gig, you know, employment pursuits, projects pursuits, in that, like, you know, for the most part, it's been the only way that the only job that I've had is like, you know, getting gigs, and it for a long time was pretty scant, you know, returns. But and having the precarity is not unfamiliar, I suppose. And so inside of some, like, familiar with some of that anxiety in so many ways, like not knowing how long your employment will last or what the next 3 months will look like or what it will look like after this thing is done. It's like, it's rarely been the case. So being able to just kind of like focus on the work and be grateful that you have it and be grateful for, like, you know, that we do get to make the decisions about our, you know, who your small pod will be composed of, you know, our collaborators in this instance. So in that way, yeah, we're like fairly well suited for the lockdown.
That's interesting that the precarity of gig-based work was like really, you know, exaggerated or really became very apparent and top of mind during the pandemic. And that's something that a lot of artists are already living and breathing. So
exactly. Yeah. 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 Well, and, you know, watching friends, service industry, you know, bartenders, mm-hmm. so many people lost their jobs, like been on unemployment or, you know, whatever it is. And like, we've been very busy, like too much so at certain points. So I guess there's that too.
The video, well, it's funny,
like COVID, not having any of the other sort of social distractions to kind of like, when you're exhausted from working all the time, to be able to go out and kind of exhaust yourself more doesn't exist anymore. So it's like, really, you're just like, I'm exhausted, and it's because I'm working 80 hours a week on this thing. And like, it's funny how like COVID has allowed for like sort of being like, I need to reevaluate some of those systems for working or something in this way, because it's like, going, I'll die from it at a certain point probably.
So that, I mean, coming out of COVID, when we get back to any sense of normality, I mean, do you think your creative practices in addition to your social practices are going to change dramatically?
No,
not really. Not create social practice, maybe. And like,
I mean, you were just saying going out less.
Will continue to take my better care of myself to be able to continue to create, maybe. I
guess having the social life option is like some form of therapy or something when it is like the studio kind of grind all the time.
Yeah.
Like having the mandatory step out and like talk to people is important. Very important. And it's certainly a difficult component of the last year, no question.
Well, yeah, I don't have anything else, I guess.
Should we hit the next clip?
Yeah, we got another clip. So I'll set it up a little bit. You've seen some of these clips, like what's up right now, working with Leon Vinehall, and a number of singles have come out in the last few months towards the new album. But in working towards this, we had started on this before the pandemic stuff started, and it went on a certain kind of hold. And when it came back, it had actually pivoted towards doing this live stream performance called A Little More Liquid. And it was an hour long live streamed performance. And we have a few short clips cut together of that, and we can keep talking about it. Thank you.
know what I mean?
That's the end of the clip.
I know Zoom has some like lag things going on for really everything.
Sorry if my face looked grumpy there.
So at some point I feel that piece in whole will be available. I know it's currently not. It was a ticketed stream. I know everyone's kind of like experimenting with how to have an audience while people aren't gathering in public. But that was kind of like one of the, you know, exciting challenges of that project. And of course, you know, we've all seen a number of different instances of people doing stream stuff. But it was exciting to like have that kind of like remote dialogue with Leon Vinehall and a Child Studios who did the videography, and kind of like working through the vision together and them shooting it in London, kind of like post conversation, a few PDFs back and forth, and then ultimately getting the footage and then having that to work with to kind of like build what the final video really was out of it all. But it was cool to, you know, I guess the initial conversation, just like talking about like in everyone's lack of space, it was exciting to approach the project and kind of try and make a video that addresses being in space. And so that whole first section, first half hour, is like the slow zoom inside of like a massive warehouse, kind of with like the lighting rig, all kind of, you know, After Effects lighting rig that we made. And it's like, as you slowly get closer to the performer, and at the end of it, it's kind of like the intimate shot. Yeah, space, when space is the subject, when we have no immense space around us, I guess.
Well, that's a cool thing about animation too, is you can just make it all up.
Movie
you
magic.
Just get to invent it as you go along.
I've got a question about, we're kind of at near the end of the presentation. We've seen sort of different eras of your work over the past 15 years. And I'm curious about the idea of like your progression and your trajectory. And I see like an obvious difference, although it feels all very aligned and like of the same people, like of you. I feel like the newer stuff, I can see aspects of it more clearly. There's elements of it that feel more defined. I don't know if that is like sort of the evolution of your practice, or if that's actually the evolution of like your collaborative network and who you're making work for and how some of this stuff really relies on the scale of it. So I guess I have a lot of questions embedded in there, but like one is when you're making work as crazy as this and like crazy maximalist and or dirt ball, what did you call it?
Yeah, dirt ball aesthetic. Is that what dirt we were
ball,
calling it?
Dirt ball aesthetic. How do you know that when you're crafting it successfully? Like, how do you know when a video clip is good or a single image?
Sure.
And I think it's really apparent. Like, you can see it. You can see something that's made with like an integrity of a craft and a practice behind it and experience. But like, what does that mean to you? And like, how are you pushing your work forward, I guess?
I mean, it brings up so many different ideas with all that. But I mean, I don't know. I think about it a lot, like with collage, right? And collage is cool in this way because it's very self-explanatory. It's very accessible. Anybody can make a collage pretty readily. And you can throw a bunch of stuff on a picture plane and there it is. A lot of this is very maximal, but there definitely is a sweet spot to a lot of it where not all maximal collage is good. Actually, most of it's subjectively not, I guess, but not good. So yeah, developing your eye and developing your sensibility for like what really starts to hit that mark is part of it, and like zeroing in on being better at teasing that out is certainly part of it. Doing it for 15 years, and I keep on seeing Crystal's face on my feet over here, but like I think of her where she was. One of the things I think back to early time working with her is just like putting down like a really simple mark, and like her like egg drawing that inspired many egg drawings on my part for years to follow, but just like something so simple, and you see someone doing it, you're just like, that's so good. It's so good. It's like, and it's not that easy. It actually takes like a deft hand to pull off the minimal parts sometimes. The dirt ball aesthetic, you want to talk about that?
I like to call it pragmatism.
Pragmatism.
But you can call it dirt ball aesthetic if you want.
You wrote it, buddy.
Did I?
I don't know.
I think I did. But I think it's just a lot of it's like, yeah, it's like for every good image that's, or like everything that's kind of like locked in or like looks, everything does have that attention to detail applied to it, even if it's not a nice image. And like, what's really important is being able to have a nice and a not a nice image. And when they're put together, like what starts to happen when those things are in concert with one another, or like that's like the idea of editing or like collage, I guess, as far as it like continues to manifest itself in our work together or individually or whatever. But I think that it's really the attention to detail, which is like calling it dirtball aesthetic, I think, is downplaying like the economical and like just the amount of responsibility we have as like individuals working together to like make sure of that success.
Make sure it hits. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, but it takes, it's that deft hand is part of it too, where it's like the way you are able to capture on an iPhone is not, you know, not everyone is taking iPhone videos that hit in the same way, you know, like it's simple and it's accessible, but it's good. You know, it's like, it's like a drawing. You know how drawings are made, you know how a collage is made, but like there is a difference when you can like, you know, wield that tool and like execute something with it, communicate something with it. The whole conversation kind of like ties into another conversation we've all been having with Emmett preparing for this, is like the desktop publishing thing is part of that too, where it's again like using these accessible tools to create like real emotional experiences, where like the 715 video, I think, is a really great example of it, where it's a text edit file and it really is just typing out the song lyrics and putting it over not even animated, you know, like screensaver desktops. But
I mean, and that song can do it. That song will make you cry, you know, by itself. But it's crazy when you watch a video of a text edit file and it like, and it's hitting you. Or the Ross Gay video is another example of it, where it's literally, you know, whatever, 300, 500 stock photos, like, you know, cringe stock photos, and a really simple, you know, compressed typeface, but like, the poetry is super powerful, and you start watching that video and it's, you're like, stock photos, it looks like an advertisement. It looks like a commercial in a bad way almost. But as you continue to watch it, like the sequencing and like the way a stock photo moves into another stock photo, moves into another one with a disjointed word over it, there's a complexity and attention to detail that's occurring that in that experience, that is really considered, and it is really complicated, and it is like difficult and beautiful, you know, in the end.
And it's like the Ross, it's like doing the stuff. I'm it's like showing the hand here a little bit, but like that, the slideshow is actually like tweaked, so it gets slightly faster and faster and faster as you're watching it. So you're not kind of like, initially you're kind of like, oh, it's a slow moving slideshow, but then by the time you're 80% in, like the images are on screen much less, and it's like paced in this way that is like pulling the viewer in, or in theory, it's kind of like, yeah, it's like getting you more excited, and then it like culminates in a way that is appropriate. Or it's like a good crescendo.
Effects occurring as well.
And all of that can happen like on the screen of an iPhone. I mean, and that's something you had mentioned earlier, like, embracing, you know, these somewhat lesser technologies as spaces where you can still create awe for people.
Totally. Well, and then like, you know, maybe they don't have access to a computer screen or something, you know, so like what we're doing isn't necessarily about that technology as much as just taking it, giving it the consideration of the viewer, the same ability to see something really cool on like wherever they're at or whatever, you know.
I think of you know, short before I had a smartphone, ultimately, I remember a friend of ours, Joseph Midtoon, was going on about having a cell phone that takes video, and just like, you know, kind of, it's probably some kind of like stoner conversation kind of vibe of a thing, but like having the moment where you're just like, man, when I was younger, like all I wished I had was like a camcorder, a video that I could just put in my pocket. I would make videos all the time, make my feature. And he's like, and now I have one, and I never take any videos. You know, I'm sure he takes a lot of videos, but I think about that conversation, or just like, I like to acknowledge and employ the simple tools that we have readily available to us at all time, and like, and knowing how powerful they can be, making the something out of nothing has a long time been it's part of it.
Cool. Well, it's time for the Q&A section. I have one quote I wanted to read before that, but before I do, was there any part, was there anything you still wanted to touch on that we haven't touched on yet?
I think I'm good.
What's up, everybody?
Let's get down to the nitty gritty.
So let's see. Okay, I'm going to save my quote maybe for the end, because it's like one of those really touching quotes that's going to get everybody. We've been collecting questions from the audience, which I have a list of those, and I could read some of those. They're great, great questions. But we were also hoping to open it up for people to literally be able to unmute their mics and ask Eric and Aaron a question, and we're not sure how that's going to go. So I don't know, maybe this is a Minnesota crowd, so everybody will be very polite, which will result in long, awkward silences. And if that happens, I have some backup questions. But if anybody wants to unmute your mic and ask some questions of the two boys here, please do. And we'll just wait for it.
Can you hear me?
We can hear you.
Hi, this is Herman Milligan. What year did you do your performance at the Soul Factory?
2005, maybe.
Oh yeah, great. So I just wanted to really thank you for all your great work there, and that you are now doing and have done.
Herman, that's thank you. That's cool to hear from you.
It's good to see you.
Yeah, I mean, I was just amazed. I said, I think I know these names.
Oh, we have shook hands.
Right.
there was like a, so this was that, there was like a skateboard show we did at a long time ago. And then the one with Crystal and Derek Maxwell and Laserbeak and a number of other people involved was probably 2006 or 2007, amongst a number of other ones. Yeah. But that was an important space for us for sure. Something we've talked about a lot, kind of reminiscing on our Minneapolis beginnings of the work, was, how important it was to have agency and access and community in that space. It's one of the reasons why we continued to live and work in Minneapolis for years, after college, in a lot of ways, between DIY spaces and houses, but also having access to stuff like the Soap Factory was immensely important, giving support to us when we were very young, and beautiful industrial spaces, and led into doing stuff at the MIA, and it led into doing stuff now in New York for a long time. But
all right, thank you, and your work is wonderful.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, can you hear me?
Yeah, yeah. We can hear you.
Yes.
Yeah, so I have a question about how you go about choosing the medium. I know a lot of it is just accumulating a lot of art and content over a long period of time. But if you have something specific in mind and you maybe don't have an idea of whether it's going to end up being a painting or pen or photography, how do you narrow that down to decide exactly what that specific piece will be?
Yeah, I don't know. There's a lot of different ways that happens. I feel like part of it is just having regular practice of your own that developing your voice in something. So, I feel like we've probably said it a lot, but drawing is one of the things that started our relationship of working together at all. Aaron and I started working on a comic book that we didn't make comics and never finished the comic book, but we started making performance installation video experiences shortly thereafter. But drawing is still something that's inherent, native, part of the practice. Do it essentially every day still. And so shoot videos and photos on your phone and stuff all the time. And
I think a lot of the video and photo stuff that we started working with too was kind of functionally, other than if it was collage photographs or source material that we were finding, it was kind of documenting what we were doing first.
Yeah.
And then it kind of turned into using pictures as images that we were generating ourselves too.
Simultaneously there was the blog or Flickr, yeah, exactly. And these kind of early internet kind of engagement that it was pretty straight up using Blogger had a huge influence on our aesthetic to this day.
Really rudimentary HTML skills.
But I don't know, a lot of it, if it's a client project or something like that, it's where you do the brief, it's where you do the research, it's where you do the process to determine what does make sense of that. But on the other hand, if it's something where it's you really get to put your voice into it, then I don't know, you follow your
follow your heart. You make what comes out. And if it makes sense to be a drawing, you know, that's a thing. If it makes sense to like be kind of typographic and sterile or something like that, like, I don't know, if you can feel it, that's what you move with.
Sweet, makes sense. Thank you, big fan.
Absolutely, thank you.
Hey, could I ask a question as well?
Yeah,
what yes, you got? Please.
Is it just you two who are doing the editing? Or do you source editors as well?
It's just me.
It's just you. That's amazing, honestly.
It's me. Eric does color correction though sometimes.
How do you have the time to do like such a massive video? Just
I just work on it. I'm on my computer a lot.
Okay.
Texting with Eric.
I mean,
does this look good?
I'm sure there's a, you know, there's certain workflow stuff you develop, but yeah, for the most part, you just get into the work.
Yeah, it's all, I mean, we've never really worked in any other system to teach us a different way. Like when I watch a movie, I see all these names at the end that they all have these jobs that Eric and I are just doing a lot of that a lot of the time. Other people do definitely do stuff too, but like. Editing is pretty much just me for the most part. Did that answer your question? I'm sorry.
No, that did. I just want to say as well, like, you guys are massive inspirations to me.
Cool.
And I really appreciate all the work you put into it.
Cool. Thank you. Oh, I guess as far as editing is concerned, we just use After Effects too. No Premiere.
Do you use Blender at all?
No. It's all kind of After Effects and then kind of, you know, we'll get some like image treatments by like shooting stuff off screens or walls or something like that.
Yeah.
But like, you know, we can run the video file through some DIY effects processors before the end a lot of times, but.
Amazing. Cool. Thank you.
Thank you.
Have something. Imagine you guys were talking about like generating a community that you guys love to create in.
Mm-hmm.
So imagine like you are stuck in an island, like you're on a flight, and then the flight gets broken, and then
lost.
And you're on this new island.
Yeah.
And then you need to generate the space in anywhere. Like how or what's the first thing you do? Like you travel, luggage is gone.
Water? I guess we'd have to find water first. Is it two? Are we together on an island? Like, do we have each other's?
Yeah.
Can we work together?
Yeah, that's fair.
Okay, water first, then shelter.
Uh-huh. But it'll be like this. Yeah, sculptural.
But close to the ocean, you know? Yeah, it would be cool to have a shelter closer to the ocean.
You know, we can work in isolation also, but
does that answer your question? Sorry, this is a really good question. For one.
No, like the main idea was like, you know, how do you generate these places that people love to work together? But I was just fucking around as well, so I didn't love you guys.
No, that's cool. Appreciate it.
I mean, you know, we're pretty good at keeping ourselves occupied. On our own time as well.
I have a quick question. Fonts. You guys use so much text in your work. How do you pick out these fonts? Like, and this may be a simple no, but did you have any input on the hobo font on like the new Bon Iver works and all that stuff? Like, just interested. There's so much text going on.
Hobo font.
fonts. I like fonts. I have oftentimes, or like a typical thing is like I've zeroed in on just like a handful that I typically start with for anything, and just like being very explicit. It's just like using Universe and Arial and Garamond times. It's Courier. pretty much, you know, what I'll use for anything, you know, maybe a Franklin. I keep it typically very basic, not cool, and and I like it that way. But then, of course, use a lot of like, you know, crazy fonts and like bad fonts and stuff like that as well. Aaron rips it on that stuff. The hobo for the Bon Iver font, like the short story of it is that Justin Vernon played with the Grateful Dead band and on his green room door in hobo font, which he and many others call the Grateful Dead font. Bon Iver was written in hobo and he took a photograph of it and sent it to me. And then I vector traced that, and that is the Bon Iver hobo logo.
It's interesting. Yeah.
I think a lot of when we started working together, we were using text edit to communicate and to like write grant applications and write, like we would do a show and we had to like write what we were doing. And it was a way, like text edit was a way to communicate with each other. And then changing the fonts in text edit was like kind of, at least for me, kind of like really the first time I didn't take like design classes in college or anything. And I took type one once, but it was like knowing what was bad. And it's like kind of like trying to use something that's bad and like remove that negative connotation through like the usage of it.
Yeah.
Or like playing with that and like trying to like, or like the, I didn't even know that Optima was a bad font.
I don't know if it's a bad font. It's like on war memorials.
You
know?
Until Eric used it for 22 a million. And then he explained to me.
It just looked right.
But I've had a problem with hobo font since 2006, for sure.
But it's like, you know, you see, it's that stuff where it's like any things that are supposed to be bad or things, whatever. This, none of it's super real. So you know, it's fun to make Papyrus hit and it's fun to make hobo hit, or like, you know, this stencil font on the Crazy Mon zine cover right there is a literal fonts.com download called Crass Font. I don't know. There's a, what is his name? There was an interview in the Third Rail with a filmmaker and he uses, you know, fonts in his like, in his films, titles, stills, section dividers. And there's like a quote about like, oh, how do you choose your typefaces? And it's something to the extent of like, design has long since been usurped by advertising. And I try to stay as far away from design as possible in making these decisions. So, you know, I have a lot of different approaches and, you know, I like nice design too, but it's also a pleasure to destroy it and do something great the wrong way.
Can I ask one more quick follow-up? It could be yes or no, but are you ever out in the wild and you see a font and you're just like, I gotta know what that is, I want to put that to use? Or is this something that just is like in the back of your mind and comes to the last part? Because I just want to say there's a hotel I stayed at in Arizona where everything is in hobo font, the stop signs for the golf carts. I was kind of losing my mind. It's around the time that you guys started utilizing it, and I got such a kick out of it. But I was wondering like how you do get your inspirations for what you might use.
I'm definitely not a what's the font.com.
Does person. That exist?
Something I didn't know like that. Exists. Yeah. Identify.
I do like the way fonts look, and I like living here. And like seeing the sort of mass pileup of fonts next to one another and like the sort of disregard for design versus like, I just need to put my information here and like how close that can live to somebody being like, I'm gonna make this really pretty or like cool. And like, there's no, it's just why, it's just everywhere. And there's just so many words everywhere here, you know, on the walls.
I would do a shout out working for Mike Cena for a number of years after MCAD, and in the couple of years I was working with him in his studio, definitely crafted some of the
typography stills that I employ.
Well, so I have a question. Are you guys listening?
Go for it.
So how perfectionist are you guys? Like, do you analyze the results many times, go back and forth many times at work, going around in circles? Or have you already developed a level of artistic maturity that things just flow and always come out at the level you imagine? It's like a natural thing to you?
Yes, on both in a certain way, where it's like some things require all of the attention and all of the detail. And you know, certain press, like, I mean, especially like going to print with things, if you're really trying to get the result of something that you've worked on creating, then you need to do it and you need to open those press check files, you need to zoom in and you need to look at the seams of everything and like see that one pixel difference and be like, we're not doing that, you know, like we will get it. And even if it's something that looks very casual, like that can be that difference sometimes. It's like, it is that matter of like, that one pixel hang up big screen. Oh, okay. So, but at the same time, there are plenty of other scenarios of making where it's like, it's all about kind of like putting it down and that's what it is. And if that's part of the project or part of the work, then you can go that way with it sometimes for sure.
It's also one of those things too, where if it seems really minimal, it probably got redone 20 times. Yeah. And if it seems really busy and crazy,
straight ahead,
it was the first shot. Yeah. Or something. Not all the time, but like it is like just trying to make things that are like a single shot, but are still compelling, or like just one word on the screen the whole time and like still have them be like watchable is, you know, it takes a lot of time to like figure out the little nuances that make that entertaining for people.
Yeah.
Or help with that or something.
Would you ever move back to Minneapolis?
Sure. I love Minneapolis. I don't get to go there enough, that's for sure. It's been too long.
I have a question for you guys about, I guess, audience. I think your early work seems just really, you know, true to itself, like really unconcerned with, you know, I guess, attention seeking, you know, correct me if I'm wrong. And now that you both kind of are at a stage in your career where attention is very much being paid to your work, do you find that that is kind of changing how you approach things? Just how has your relationship with attention changed, I guess?
Right. I mean, the transition of that, you know, has certainly been a point of conversation, you know, as things, I mean, it was insane for the 22 million album to come out. And like with that rollout, there was something very intentional about them rolling it out, like with the acknowledgement of the artwork and kind of acknowledging the artwork as a big part of that like release. And it was weird. It's very weird. I was like prepared for it in a certain capacity, but you can't be prepared for it. But being able to work to the audience in that capacity is actually is part of the work that we've been doing for Bon Iver, in the sense that we do think about it, some of it's antagonistic in a certain capacity too. Like, but that's kind of the fun. It's what you can make certain simple things really powerful, knowing what expectations are and what expectations you're subverting or playing with. But yeah, are we like, are we holding back or something? I don't know. Like the Nuke Watch videos are,
I think,
pretty gnarly stuff. Like,
also like coming up pre-Instagram and like social media wasn't really like, it kind of existed, but like it was Facebook and none of us were really interested in that. wasn't even on it. And like we had blog, like we used a blog to like kind of publish, but it wasn't the same kind of like economy for attention that exists now. And even the way people make work didn't happen when we were doing this stuff 10 years ago. Like it wasn't as frequent, and like people didn't sort of like aspire to create certain stuff. Like it seems like there's just a lot more people making the same things as a result of like attention being paid or something, which didn't happen as much 10 years ago. And kind of now it's like, I don't read the internet for stuff. It's distracting for me to like pay attention to like people talking on the internet, I feel like, especially when it's like a professional decision too. Like personally, it's fine, but when it's like related to, it's just not helpful.
I mean, we might be, there's certainly, you know, in some of like the slides of, you know, the early stuff too, you know, we were younger for sure. And like probably we're more reckless in certain ways. So there is certainly the change that when you're not 22 anymore, but.
Yeah, you can't like. You can't like roll with that defiance forever or something, or like, yeah, it's just not, it's not effective ultimately.
So I think we've got time for maybe two more questions. And I know a bunch of people were asking questions about tattoos in the chat, and I said we would get to that. So if anybody wants to speak up with their tattoo question, that would be cool.
Yeah, I mean, hey, this is Josh. I guess I can bounce off of what Andrew was saying. My sleeve on my right arm originally started with just regular icons, right? Nothing to do with you guys' work, but then it kind of evolved into like adding y'all's art on my arm. Is that weird? I mean, I've always been a fan of iconography and always been a fan of minimalist art.
It's weird. Do you feel like it's weird?
No, I just think it's unique because the artists that I grew up liking for their iconography, like, you know, like Warhol or Keith Haring or something like that, they're not around so that I could ask for their opinion on it while you guys are. So I'm just kind of curious what you guys think about.
I have a lot of symbols on my body that Eric put on there or other people, and yeah, it's like, I don't know, I think it's cool. It doesn't feel weird to me at all. Yeah. Like it doesn't feel like a violation or something.
It's cool. Yeah. No, I mean, there's certainly something that it makes a lot of sense that there was many years of sitting around giving each other tattoos with a, you know, group of friends, and like, and drawing to that specifically, you know, it was like a certain kind of hanging out where you're like sitting around and drawing and ultimately tattooing each other. And that kind of drawing, and it's like funny usually and fun and simple and fast and reckless. And I love it. And it has certainly informed a lot of the drawing that like now do just very casually. And the work that was done for that 22 million stuff obviously is like very closely tied to that kind of drawing in a lot of ways. So it makes perfect sense that it is such a pervasive thing occurring. Happy you have the tattoos.
What's your next tattoo? Forever. What do you want to get?
I've kind of, my right arm is kind of more like photoreal. So it just kind of blended together. Like I had, this was, some graffiti and I think it was, Iran. So this is like my real simple arm, you know, and then this is more like more photoreal and I've
looks
got more.
Cool.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
I've got a quick question sort of about the design process, if that's all right.
Right. Sure.
Well, first of all, I got the 22 on my arm too. big fan of you guys. Thank you. I wanted to ask about what kind of creative mindset you guys put yourselves in when you're doing simple like iconography and symbols and phrases and things like that, how it can be so simple yet so meaningful, provoking, if that makes sense.
I mean, yeah, there's a lot of different kinds of approaches to the drawing, right? And you know, I keep a book in my pocket, and like there's plenty of like train session kind of like drawings. You can kind of sit wasting time at a restaurant, something like that. Certainly a way. But then otherwise there's like a huge chunk of the time that I spend drawing when it gets more detailed or like more attention, more intention. I'm typically watching movies, watching TV, or, you know, having like a show streaming, and I'm in my studio late night, and I just draw for hours, just watching stuff, like half watching, quarter watching stuff. But like to have a narrative kind of like occurring while drawing is really helpful in a certain way, because it just like stops a little bit of the inner dialogue that can actually be kind of distracting at times. So I like to do a lot of very small, you know, kind of quick pocket stuff, accumulate that for a certain amount of time. And then you can kind of just reassess that at any point and pull out whatever hits and take another round and develop that further. That's more or less the vibe. Aaron kind of like is
I just kind of zone out now when I do it.
Is this like staccato between renders? And
yeah, and I work as I'm like rendering on a computer, I'll draw as I'm sitting there. But if I'm working on video stuff, this isn't drawing related, but like I do have to like hype myself up pretty hard, and like watching something like hundreds of times and just being like, this has got to still be good on the 100th time or something like that, to like feel really like euphoric when I'm watching it or something.
Is like, so, sorry, didn't mean to interrupt.
Oh no, that's all.
Yeah, like for us, like the 22 million symbols and everything, they're so iconic. Like did that, and I've seen drafts of, you know, you've posted, and I've seen of some of those symbols. How easy did those come to you? Did those take a lot of refining to get to that state, or did they come pretty naturally?
I mean, like the 22 one specifically, it was honestly a pretty early on conversation with Justin about calling the album 22 a million, and having that 22 kind of like this push towards icons existing early on. And it was like Sharpie napkin drawings, where it was 15, you know, little sketches that all kind of, it got to the point of this kind of upside down interlock early on. But it was, you know, so some of them were really easy, or like the 10 kind of ankh, upside down ankh, it was just like, oh, that could see it right away. But something like the 33 symbol, for example, was not immediate, and it took a lot of like, but I don't know. Either way, like the 715 log, everyone has this, everyone I could talk about that probably came pretty quickly, but it was messy. So there's like a difference between like establishing what series of lines can make an effective symbol. But then if you want to get into the kind of like typographic detail of it, you're thinking about corners and widths, and then the relationship of any given symbol to any other symbol in the set, so they can live next to each other and have some sort of relationship. So that stuff takes a long time, even on something that might occur to you right away.
So
thank you.
Unfortunately, it seems like we're out of time. I'm sure there's a ton more questions. Yeah.
Eric and Aaron, if you don't mind, I was going to end with a quote from this interview that we're working on that hasn't been published yet. And apologies, Eric, it's actually you paraphrasing somebody else, but I think it's really appropriate. you said, I don't recall who said it, but this thought has always stuck with me. The cool thing about getting older and better at your work is that your friends get older and better at their work too. So your potential and opportunities naturally grow with you and your community, though the benefits of this are predicated on your continued engagement and contribution. So I think that's a really powerful thought. And I'm looking through the audience and I'm seeing a lot of friends and I'm seeing like a lot of talented people as well. So I think this is just a great sort of example of this quote. And so I just want to say thank you for sharing your work with us and thank you for being so engaged.
Wow.
Thanks, yeah, respond to that.
Thank you, Emmett.
Thank you so much, Emmett. Thank you, everyone who's in the cut.
Yeah, wish we could just go hang out.
I know it. It really is an honor to be able to do this. And yeah, it's crazy. Much love.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, everyone.
Wow, best part
of the lecture. This is fun.
Yeah. How many people are watching this?
We were just sticking around for karaoke. We thought that was going to start soon.
All right, what you got?
Yeah, you're up.
We were going to sing Bon Iver songs.
Oh, wow. Those are hard.
I know.
They're hard to sing.
All right, I'm going to log off. Rad.
Cool.
We're going to log off for real.
Thanks, everyone.
Bye.
Love ya.
Love ya.
Yeah.